What's going on, everybody? It's the Political Brown Kid here, back again. And I'm going to kind of do a little different Hollywood in black and white. It's going to focus on Quentin Tarantino and his subtle, or not so subtle, racism and continuous racism throughout a lot of his movies. Now, if everyone knows who Quentin Tarantino is, Quentin Tarantino is a famous director, writer. He also does acting a little bit. He even appears in some of his stuff that he does. I think I don't know if From Dusk Till Dawn was his that he wrote and produced, or if he just starred in it or not, but you may know him from there. Everyone knows him from Pulp Fiction. I think that was probably his bigger claim to fame where the masses came to know him. But then he goes way back before that with like Reservoir Dogs and stuff. But here's a problem that I have with Quentin Tarantino. Once again, like, I'll tell y'all, like, even with a lot of the Hollywoods and black and whites that I do, it's not that I'm sitting up here saying I hate every single movie that I watch. It's just that it's sometimes it's conflicting. You watch this stuff, you see the stuff that occurs in it, you know, basically how they do black people in these movies. But the movies themselves, when you look at it from an artistic perspective, they're good movies. You know, some of the ones that I've reviewed, if you go back and check my archives. So I'm going to say the same thing with Quentin Tarantino. I think he's a hell of a director, definitely a good writer. He's very creative and has a great imagination, good cinematography, all of that good stuff. But he is, you cannot deny that he does have racist tendencies. This stuff just isn't about his movies. This stuff is stuff that he feels. Because once again, as I keep telling y'all, when you do the one thing about movies, music, and all of the artistic stuff that you see, even paintings, all of that is premeditated. When you, I keep telling y'all this, and I'm a banging into your head over and over again, art is premeditated. There's very few art that's not premeditated. Even like these so-called freestyles are not necessarily freestyles. These artists have written this stuff down. A true freestyle is you coming off the dome. But when you look at a movie script, you have to outline, just like you were writing a paper, you would outline the script, right? You would start with a rough outline, a skeleton of what you're going to do, break down your scenes, break down the movie, break down your characters. Then you're going to write the movie. So you're going to have to sit up here, type the words out. Even when you're writing the movie, you're going to be scratching words out because you're thinking about it. You're going to say, oh, he's going to say this and not that. This scene, he's going to do this and not that. Then once you get the scene the way you want it after multiple rounds of editing, so again, that's heavily premeditated. Now you have to cast the characters, which is another premeditated because you're like, this character should be this color, this height, this gender. They should have these type of behaviors, this type of look. And that's the casting part. It is very deep and premeditated. So when you look at Quentin Tarantino's movies, and I'm just going to look at six of them right off the break, he does a lot of racial stuff in his movies, and a lot of it is not necessary. And I think that he wrote two movies, and I'm going to talk about those two, and y'all probably know what I'm talking about. I think he did those two movies specifically so he could do actually, you know, explicit racism and let his, you know, racist jokes fly. So just looking at it, overview, quick overview. There's two things that the pattern that I notice that Quentin Tarantino does in his movies. Number one, he loves to find a way to plug in the N-word into his movies. He also loves to do, and in doing that, he likes to tell black jokes at the expense of black people. And then the second thing he loves to do is he fetishizes black women. So let's look at Reservoir Dogs. In Reservoir Dogs, you have this scene where the four individuals are riding in a car. I forget the guy who plays, he was in Armageddon. He's a guy with like the teeth. He also played in Boardwalk Empire. Really liked him in Boardwalk Empire. His name slips my mind at this point in time. Harvey Keitel's in the car, and then there's two other individuals that I don't know. So then they just having this random conversation about black women and, you know, what black women will and will not put up with. And then it turns into a conversation about, well, black men talk to their black women like this and they treat their black women like that. So then you have this whole N-word dialogue going on in this car. So that's the first part about it, where you're just randomly plugging in, you know, having a conversation. They drop the movie's about bank robberies or robberies, and they just having this random conversation about, you know, blacks and but calling them the N-word in the car. And then they move into this talk where the fetishizing comes in. They're talking about this black woman that apparently everybody gets to nail, or that she's doing, and it's insinuated that she's banging white guys. So that's just with Reservoir Dogs. Then you can look at Pulp Fiction. Now, in Pulp Fiction, of course, that's peppered. Of course, and I think that's also the reason why him and Samuel Jackson are joined at the hip, because Samuel Jackson loves using the N-word. I think he goes to sleep saying it, and I think that's the very first word he wakes up to. I think he wakes up shouting it when he wakes up. He just loves using the N-word, and he is very much a token for white people, particularly a token for Quentin Tarantino, because they're joined at the hip, and he's in all of Quentin Tarantino's movies, and he loves being in those movies. When you look at Pulp Fiction, Samuel Jackson's character, use of the N-word, Ving Rhames is calling the actor, also the actor Bruce Willis, the N-word when he's trying to get him to throw a fight. You know, so the, and then also too, when you see the disparagement of black people in the black, you know, with the black joke, is John Travolta goes to his dealer's house to buy some brown sugar. I'm just going to put it at that point. He's going to the house, and that's not a woman. That is actually a narcotic. So he's not trying to buy a black female, but he's trying to buy some narcotic, and he's trying to buy the brown, not the white. And so when he goes to this house and he's talking to his other white dealer, they're talking about the different products and variations of this brown substance. And so he's trying to figure out which one he wants to buy. And so then the dealer looks at him and says, "Do I look like a N-word? Do I look like that?" Basically, like, you know, don't insult me. You know, but why is it that he says, "Do I look like an N-word?" Why couldn't it be, "Do I look like a, you know, a disparagement for a Hispanic, or a disparagement for an Asian, but, you know, or a disparagement for an Italian, or another white person?" Why was the focus on black at that point in time? So once again, he likes to sneak in that those racial comments. And then the fetishizing of black women comes in when you see, there's an incident that occurs. This may be a spoiler alert if you haven't seen Pulp Fiction, but there's an incident that occurs, and I'll try to be as broad as possible without giving it away. But John Travolta and Samuel Jackson need to take this car over to a friend's house, you know, to a safe house, so they can get the car quote unquote cleaned and they can get it prepped. So they need to call Harvey Keitel because he's like the cleaner. He's the cleanup guy. And while they're waiting on Harvey Keitel, they're at this other guy's house who is a white male. And he's like, you know, he's odd. And matter of fact, that character is played by Quentin Tarantino. And so Quentin Tarantino's character is like, "Man, when my wife comes home and finds y'all here, she's going to flip. Y'all have to leave." So then they kind of show this sequence scene, you know, kind of like this, you know, hypothetical scene of her coming in and seeing what they're doing in the house. And of course, it's a black woman dressed in a nurse's uniform, and she goes through the house. And of course, so they're insinuating that his wife is black. So you have, once again, you have the degradation of, in the heavy use of the N-word, the degradational shots thrown at black people, and you have the fetishizing of black women. When you also look at, I'm gonna go with Death Proof first. When you look at the movie Death Proof, that actually really wasn't so bad. The only problem that I had with Death Proof was, once again, Sidney Poitier and his whole family's pathetic. Sidney Poitier was pathetic, and even his daughter is pathetic. And I'll go on record stating that. I know a lot of you Sidney Poitier lovers are going to hate me, but he is. And I'm going to, he'll be touched on when I do my commentary on Martin Luther King, which I continually been talking about for 2 years now, but have not done so. But his daughter, she's playing a character, Jungle Julia. And of course, while they're riding in the car, they're like, "Yeah, she has a white, she has a black girl butt. She has a black girl's butt." Well, of course she has a black girl's butt. She's a black girl. But once again, just because she's a light-skinned black, they want to diminish her blackness. So she doesn't even really play a black character. And she spends her time texting her boyfriend with a white name, Dan or Andy, some name that she's texting. And she's obviously, fiending for him because she keeps texting him and he won't text her back. So then she gets mad. So once again, it's the fetishizing of the black woman, and automatically she has to be entangled with a white man. Then you can move on to the movie Jackie Brown. So I'm pretty sure a lot of people have probably seen Jackie Brown. Of course, it stars Pam Grier from the 1970s. If you ever seen Foxy, Coffee Brown, Sheba Baby, Black Mama, White Mama, something like that, or Black Mamas or Mamas or whatever, some movie where they escape from jail. I don't know these titles, but it stars her. And of course, Samuel L. Jackson, once again, back at it again, and Robert De Niro's in here. So once again, Samuel Jackson is continuously trying to school Robert De Niro, his buddy who just got out of jail, on how to run his arms business. So he deals in selling arms. You know what arms are. If you don't, look it up. So while he's selling these arms and these automatic and semi-automatic type of arms, he's talking to Robert De Niro, and basically, like, he sells a lot of these guns because a lot of the N-word people love these guns because they see so-and-so with these guns. So, you know, and he just loves to continually have these kind of talks and discussions all throughout this particular movie. And, you know, it's just, you know, just showing the ignorance and degradation of the black man once again. And then you have Jackie Brown, and of course she's kind of in this, and you can see this, the infatuation from this white guy, and I forget his name, but he plays the bail bondsman. And as soon as he sees this hot chocolate, he's a white guy, older white guy. Of course, Pam Grier's older now at this point because this movie was made in, I think, what, the 90s, early 2000s. So as soon as he sees her, they start playing the little why do fools fall in love music, the old 70s type of music. And, you know, he's just in awe of her beauty. And he just spends the rest of this movie trying to help her commit felonies because that's what he wants to do for his new brown sugar. And at the end, he even gets a little kiss from her on the lips because, of course, she couldn't be in love with a black man. They have to give Pam Grier, an icon, a white boyfriend. And then I'm going to get to the final two movies that I've talked about where he wanted to explicitly plug in his racism in these movies. And also he plugs in his fetishizing of black women in the movie as well. The first one I'm going to talk about, of course, is I'll save his most popular one for last, but I'm not going to, so I'll go out of order a little bit. So I'll talk about The Hateful Eight at this point. Now, mind you, The Hateful Eight was a decent movie. It was pretty decent. Walt Goggins is in there, and Walt Goggins played okay. It has Kurt Russell, and of course, Samuel L. Jackson's back again. Jennifer Jason Leigh is in the movie too, and I thought Jennifer Jason Leigh did a great job in the character that she played. It was glad to see her back on the screen. I don't think I've seen her since the 80s. I wasn't around in the 70s, since the 80s, but I've seen her movies before. So with The Hateful Eight, the whole movie is really just a lot of dialogue, but it's like I said, he does good movies. And of course, this whole movie, because of the time period that it's in, and this is why I say he likes to do explicit stuff, because this movie is based probably about what, the 1800s, maybe even the early 1900s. They're driving in stagecoaches. They're going to like little small Western towns. So this is probably an early 1900s movie, maybe 1910, 1920. I don't know. But as they're riding around in the stagecoach, boy, do they give Walt Goggins the chance to use the N-word. And he fires off the N-word every chance he can get. And he's just using it. And of course, you know, when they get to the place that they're going to, there's an older white guy who's an obvious racist there as well. And of course, he gets to fire off the N-word. So they get a chance to kind of have these N-word dialogues, these little N-word jokes, at the expense of Samuel L. Jackson's character. And then the fetishizing comes in because the movie kind of does a little quick scene, because the movie really just focuses on five or six characters, but then they kind of have to show you a setup scene, and it shows you how they took over this. It's a haberdashery, which is known as a, I guess, I thought haberdashery would be a clothing store, but this one is really looks like more like an old Western convenience store. And it was owned by a black woman, but yet she is with a white man. And the white man that she's with, he sits in the saloon all day. They never really show them together, like doing anything, you know, hugging or touching, but she calls him an affectionate word, babe. And, you know, she's seeking validation from him. So it goes to show you that this light-skinned black woman is with this white man, because of course they couldn't pair her up with a black man. And then finally, the final movie that I was going to save is kind of also a time period, and it goes along with The Hateful Eight. It's probably around, well, no, it's earlier than The Hateful Eight, because this one actually occurred during slave time, and everyone should know what I'm talking about, and that would be Django Unchained. So Django Unchained had to be before slavery, you know, before the abolition of slavery, should I say. So it's around 1850s, maybe. So in this movie, this has Jamie Foxx in it. And of course, Samuel L. Jackson is back once again. Samuel L. Jackson is actually in all of these movies that I've just talked about, except for Death Proof and Reservoir Dogs But of course, Samuel Jackson plays Leonardo DiCaprio's slave boy, plays his little house Negro. And he just wants to protect Leonardo DiCaprio at all costs. So as soon as he sees Jamie Foxx, he just has all kind of N-word jokes. He just has all kind of N-word vitriol and hatred. And they're just throwing up the dialogue. They're really not supposed, I don't think that he meant for them to be. When you look at the movie, some of y'all have said, well, those aren't supposed to be jokes. It's supposed to be him being hatred, him showing hatred towards Jamie Foxx's character, Django. But you have to look at it from the perspective of Quentin Tarantino writing. I mean, like, who's going to write jokes like, man, if you let this N-word sleep in the main house, in the bed, we're going to have to burn the bed sheets. And, you know, he's just throwing in all of these other little talks. You know, hey, we got to treat, we're not going to treat Django like a free man. We got to treat him like he's the R word, like the, you know, a mentally disabled white person. We can't treat him like a regular white person. So there's all of these little subtle jokes and jabs. And then where you see the fetishizing of black women come into play, or black woman come into play, because once again, he always fetishizes one black woman in each of his films. If people probably don't even notice this in this movie, but you should have, it's a fancy girl. And if you don't know what a fancy girl is, go look it up. So there's a fan, but surprisingly, to be honest with you, I don't even know if we can call her a fancy girl, because I'm going to call her a fancy girl. I say she's a fancy girl. Some people may disagree, because I think one of the qualifications for being a fancy girl was you had to be like what Thomas Jefferson's slave girl, whatever that girl's name was, that everybody wants to romanticize, but technically that relationship was a little different. But everyone wants to romanticize it. But basically, fancy girls were light-skinned. They were mixed slaves that the white slave owners would have their way with. And also, they would actually lend them out to other people as well to have their way with them as well. So they were pretty much like high-priced escorts. From what I heard that they, like back in the day, you could, like a fancy girl, in order for like a slave master to let another person sleep with his quote unquote fancy girl, which is a light skinned concubine, that's what she was, a bed wench concubine, you know, they had to pay about upwards of $2,000, like as low as $500, as high as $2,000 to $5,000. And apparently that was $2,000 is equivalent to like, I think about $70,000 or $80,000, $90,000, between that range for that time period. So, you know, you had to pay big bucks just to have an encounter with her. And the slave master, you know, typically she was his on lock, and that was his That was his little thing. But fancy girls were typically the mulattoes that came out of the relationships that the slave masters had. He would, keep her looking good. He would, have her, I guess, in the house. She wasn't no common field slave because she had to be able to stay dainty and so they could have their way with him. But in The Hateful Eight, there was a brown-skinned fancy girl. I'm still gonna call her fancy girl because she's very pretty. Now, of course, once again, they're not gonna hire no when a white man is talking about, banging a black woman, she's always gonna be fine. She's always gonna be a pretty one. They're never gonna cast themselves with an ugly black woman. Black men, we just cast anything when we do movies. We don't care. But, and I'm not saying that in a positive way for black men. You do better. But in this case, if you look at the movie when Django is actually this doctor, this dentist actually buys him, but not really buys him. He's actually a dentist slash bounty hunter. Well, he's actually a bounty hunter, but he hasn't done dentistry in a long time. He uses that kind of as his cover, but he kind of buys Django to help himself point out certain people that are on a wanted dead or alive list. And so, he gets Django and Django's helping him out, but he tells Django, I'm going to give you your freedom because I don't believe in slavery, but I just need you for this one job and then, I'll give you your freedom. And so, but then that turns into a relationship of them going down this path because now he's trying to help Django get his wife back. He finds out that Django was married. He finds out that Django has this love story and he's like, man, I'm going to help you get your wife back. So that's how they wound up meeting Leonardo DiCaprio's character. And when they meet him, they go to Leonardo DiCaprio's parlor because Leonardo DiCaprio and them are having a fight with the two, I don't know what kind of African warriors or African wrestlers they are, but they're watching this fight. And all the while, you got this nice fancy girl sitting in there. She's the only female in the room, period, I think, that's not serving because the other females are actually working. But, she's in there dressed fancy, drinking her champagne, doing her thing, and she's actually looking at Django and even the other white guy like, y'all are beneath me. I'm with a real man. I'm with Leonardo DiCaprio. He owns all this property and he owns all these slaves. I'm not a slave. I'm something different. I'm a fancy girl. But I don't make this stuff up with Quentin Tarantino in this writing. When you watch Quentin Tarantino's movie, check out the subtle differences that you'll see in this. I don't make this stuff up. But yeah, that's just my take. I just wanted to do this Hollywood in black and white on Quentin Tarantino and just kind of do a quick rundown of his films and just the patterns that I've seen within his films. But if you have any other comments on any of his other works or just want to point out some things out that I may have missed, definitely drop them in the comments section. Also hit the like and subscribe button. Once again, this is the Political Brown Kid. Take care.